Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. You know, one of the really amazing aspects of Jewish history in the Iberian Peninsula is the remarkable survival of crypto-Judaism in Portugal in particular. What I'd like to look at today is one specific aspect of why Judaism was able to survive about 500 years of persecution by going underground during the period of the Inquisition, and it's specifically along the Douro River. So let's just have a quick recap on what was the Portuguese Inquisition. To understand it properly, you have to go back to Spain in the late 14th century, when there was a series of pogroms and forced conversions in 1391. This created a really large population of people who were technically Christian. They had been baptized against their will, and according to church law, they were in fact now Catholics, but they deeply resented this fact. There was an upside, though, because now, as Christians, they had, you know, carte blanche to, you know, live wherever they wanted, go to higher institutions of learning, to pursue any kind of occupation they want. And so over the course of the 15th century, these crypto-Jews, because they were quite often secretly practicing Judaism, still marrying with Jews, still studying Jewish texts, still keeping kosher, things like that, they began to penetrate many different aspects of Spanish society. This caused a lot of tension. By the time you get to the 15th century, the Spanish kings Ferdinand and his queen Isabella instituted the Inquisition, which was essentially a way to root out those Jewish practicing Jews who were portraying themselves as Catholics. At this point, we're talking about three, four generations of Catholics now. They were called New Christians or Conversos, or the derogatory term Marrano, which means pig. And there's a lot of interesting debate among historians. Was the primary purpose of the Inquisition to kind of generate religious uniformity in Spain, which we definitely see a huge push for that, or was it sort of a socioeconomic backlash against the Jews taking positions in parts of society where before the forced conversions they had not gone? So this Inquisition was technically directed only at those Jews who had been forcibly converted and their descendants, again, now three, four generations in. In 1492, Ferdinand and Isabella took a much more drastic step, following the suggestion of the Grand Inquisitor Torquemada, to expel all the Jews of Spain. And this, now we're talking about the Jews who had not been baptized, not the crypto-Jews, with the reasoning that it was the presence of traditional Jews, practicing Jews, openly practicing Jews, that were keeping the new Christians from abandoning their Jewish faith. And so the idea was get rid of all the Jews. And that's how we get to Portugal, because in 1492, there's a massive wave of Jews who leave Spain, and many of them cross the land border to the west into Portugal, especially along the Douro River Valley. I'm going to show you a map of that shortly. Portugal handled these migrants, some of whom were legal and many of whom were illegal, with difficulty. And in 1497, ultimately, Portugal took a rather drastic step. Rather than expelling those Jews, because they did represent a significant economic advantage for the country, they decided simply forcibly convert them all en masse. And so that's, in fact, what happened in 1497. However, Portugal did not institute the Inquisition. We can have discussions about it. Apparently, they hoped that the problem would go away on its own, and they actually put a stay on the Inquisition for a number of decades. It was only in 1536 that Pope Paul III finally brought the Inquisition formally to Portugal with this papal bull, Cum ad nihil magis. And in fact, the Portuguese Inquisition was in many ways even more savage than the Spanish Inquisition. So that's basically what happened. By the time you get to the fourth decade of the 16th century, the entire peninsula is under the supervision of the Inquisition, and the hunt for crypto-Jews is relentless and often ends in these horrific auto da fé, these public burnings, sometimes burnings in effigy, sometimes burning of corpses. There's a lot more to say about this, but that's basically the situation. Now let's look specifically at Portugal and the Douro River in particular. Here's a map of the Douro River. You can see that it starts in Spain and it moves towards the west and empties into the Atlantic Ocean. It's actually a very beautiful river. I mean, just gorgeous, with rolling hills and little vineyards, and I think it's one of the most beautiful rivers in Europe, actually. It also has a remarkable height differentiation. In order to, like, traverse the Douro River, you have to go through these massive constructions called locks, which move the boats literally up or down to be able to travel all of it. But at any rate, why is this so significant for crypto-Judaism? Primarily because if you look at this map here, you can see that the Douro River is primarily in the top, but the main centers of the Inquisition are quite a bit to the south. There's Coimbra, which is a very important university town that was a notable center of the Inquisition. But the other two were quite a bit further south, in Lisbon and in Évora. And the region of the Douro River, which is dotted with these little hilltop settlements, it was basically the hinterland. It was far away from the big urban centers. The closest one was Porto, which also had a very large Jewish community, then and now, actually. But these tiny little communities where you might have 5 families, 10 Jewish families, or crypto-Jewish families, they were able to basically be out of the way of most of the attention of the Inquisition. Communities like Belmonte, Trancoso, these were basically where crypto-Jews could more or less stay under the radar, and they did so for a remarkable 500 years, preserving all kinds of internal Jewish traditions, sometimes highly modified Jewish traditions to understand and to adapt to the environment in which they lived. And this basically was a situation until the early 20th century, when Samuel Schwartz, shown here, who was a Polish Jewish engineer, was in the region. And, he was kind of like an amateur ethnographer, and he was just asking around with different things, and people said, whatever you do, don't do business with those people up in Belmonte, because, you know, they're actually Jews. And he was fascinated. Jews in this part of Portugal, the Inquisition has been here since 1536. It's almost 500 years later. He goes up there and he encounters them, and it's kind of a funny story. They don't believe he's Jewish at first. Only after meeting specifically with the village elder, who quizzes him, gives him a farher, an exam on the spot, and he was able to, for example, recite the Shema prayer, then she finally said, oh, he's Jewish, and in fact, they accept him. So these little communities far to the north and quite remote were able to shelter these Jewish populations for such a long time, and it is one of the most fascinating aspects of European Jewish history. I'm really looking forward to going there with Kosher Riverboat Cruises. It is one of my favorite spaces to visit in Europe, and I hope some of you will join me. Thank you very much for watching.